I'm Alana Rocha with the Texas Tribune. We're here at ground zero, if you will, for vaccine development of COVID-19, the new coronavirus. It's the McLellan Lab at the University of Texas at Austin. I'm joined by Jason McLellan, lead researcher here and associate professor. Your lab has kind of had a major breakthrough in this. I guess talk about it and what it means in layman's terms.
Sure. So what we've done is we've determined the first three-dimensional structure or a three-dimensional map of this coronavirus's spike protein. So the surface of the virus contains these projections, these spike proteins that look sort of mushroom-shaped molecules, and they're critical for the virus to infect us. So these spike proteins bind to receptors on our cells and then fuse our cell membranes with the viral cell membranes to allow the viral contents to enter our cells and then infect the cells. And so by having this three-dimensional map of the spike protein, we can then begin to rationally develop vaccines, antibodies, and small molecule drugs that can bind and prevent the function of this spike.
And the World Health Organization is calling for solidarity in this, so you then share that with the science world?
Yeah, exactly. So we've been super busy the last couple of weeks just sharing reagents and the map with researchers all over the world. So we've been mailing the plasmids that make the protein, purified protein itself, the three-dimensional map, to labs everywhere who have their own take on development of interventions, and we're just trying to facilitate those efforts.
You guys, a critical breakthrough, and you kind of had the upper hand here. Talk about, you know, your lab has been researching coronaviruses for years.
Yeah, that's right. We started working on coronaviruses in 2013 after the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus emerged in 2012, 2013. And we felt that it was likely there'd be additional coronavirus outbreaks in the future. And we worked together to determine the first three-dimensional structures of coronaviruses in general. And as soon as we knew that this virus that was in China at the end of December was a coronavirus, we were immediately able to translate all of our prior knowledge to generate these spike proteins quickly in the lab, get the structure, have our colleague at the NIH begin testing it in animals. They're working with a company to now make the initial vaccine lots, which have shipped and starting to enroll in phase one clinical trials. So it's incredibly fast.
Yeah, put that in perspective. Everybody wants a vaccine yesterday for this COVID-19. What does the timeline look like?
So for this particular virus, or the vaccine development for this virus, you would first have to do a phase one clinical trial, which generally involves tens of people, 30 to 40 people, and we're looking mostly for safety to make sure that the vaccine isn't causing any adverse effects. Then, if that looks good, you'd go to a phase two clinical trial, which is in the hundreds of people, still looking mostly at safety, a little bit in terms of efficacy, is it doing what we want it to? If that looks good, you go to a phase three clinical trial where you enroll thousands of people. Generally, some fraction of that population gets the vaccine, the other fraction gets a placebo, and then you can look to see how many people in each group became infected, and is the vaccine helping to prevent infections or is it helping to prevent severe disease? So it's a long process. There's just no way to, you have to enroll people, you have to treat them, follow them, and it takes time in order to make a safe and efficacious vaccine. But 18 to 24 months is incredibly fast. Most vaccines take 1 to 2 decades to develop.
Now, you've done that critical phase that's being shared with labs around the world. You all are also working on a vaccine and other treatments. Talk a little bit about that,
sure.
Again, in layman's terms.
Yeah, sure. So there's multiple ways to intervene and fight these viruses. So a vaccine is one method. Our colleagues at the NIH are sort of going to lead the next phase and develop that further. What we're working with is a number of groups and companies to isolate antibodies from people who have survived the infection. So when you get infected, your body makes antibodies to fight off the virus. We can then use our spike protein sort of as a bait to fish out these antibodies from people. Those antibodies can then be scaled up and produced and then injected into people. They can be injected into people who aren't sick, like healthcare workers who might be exposed to it, or even to people who are sick and maybe try to reduce the disease severity. And then other groups are using our structural models to do a small molecule screening. They can screen on the computer a virtual library of compounds and how they dock to our map, and then try and identify a couple of top hits or lead candidates that they can then test experimentally in the lab.
Jason, a lot of panic right now surrounding this, but can you put in perspective, as we said, you know, and as you've said, you've studied coronaviruses for years. Is it just the newness that's scaring people of this?
Yeah, well, I think it is a serious virus. It is now a pandemic, according to the World Health Organization. The case fatality rate is somewhere in 1 to 2 or 1 to 3%. So it is killing a substantial number of people who are infected by it. And it appears to be spreading person to person more easily than some of the other coronaviruses like SARS and MERS. Although those had much higher case fatality rates. SARS had a case fatality rate of around 10% and MERS was around 35%. So less lethal, but much more easily to spread. And so it is concerning, you know, 1% of a million people or however many people ultimately affects is a lot of people. And so I think governments, cities, organizations are making the right call by trying to prevent these large gatherings, a lot of conferences, South by Southwest was closed. I think these measures will look very reasonable in several weeks' time. Jason, if not already.
Jason McLellan here at the McLellan Lab at University of Texas at Austin. We'll let you get back to it.
Thank you.